حسان يا حسان حسان يا حسان. السلام عليك يا أبا عبد الله وعلى الأرواح التي حلت بفنائك. لقد عاد حزني والبكاء وتألمي مذ أبصرت عيني هلال محرم ولبست فيه ولبست ثوب الحزن فيه واسعا آل النبي الأطهار بمأتمي ثم انثنيت إلى الهلال مخاطبا والدمع مني قد جرى كالأندمي. My grief returns, so do my hailing tears and endless sorrow. Soon as my eyes witness the crescent and Muharram glow, I dress myself in black garments in ways to show condolences to Ahlul Bayt and the world while my eyes overflow. Bika ya hilal adad juyush umayyatan wa li al ahmad ahraqat أزكى دمي. بك يا هلال هو ابن بنت فاطمة ابن بنت محمد تركته شر جماعة لم ترحمي. بك جسمه فوق الصعيد مبضعا وبما به في قلبه سهما رمي والرأس شيل على القناة بينهم يعظ العباد بأي ذكر محكم يتلو الكتاب كأنما هو سالم. I looked up with complaint, I addressed the moon, calling out under your glow, Bani Umayyah left the holy body slaughtered at Abjud. O moon of Muharram, you have many sad tales to tell, when you rose, the father son of Fatima fell. You witnessed lay lifeless, you witnessed Hussain lay lifeless after they crushed into his body parts. You saw what came out of his holy back when he removed the arrow from his heart. O moon of Muharram, with your birth the greatest tragedy was uncovered. They removed the head of Hussain and made his household suffer. Under your glow, demon, the holy heads were stacked. You shined on Hussein's head, reciting holy verses as if it were still intact. Under your glow, demon, they burnt the woman's tent. You witnessed as the woman and children weren't allowed to lament. Hussain, ya Hussain, Hussain, ya Hussain, inna lillahi. الله وإنا إليه راجعون وسيعلم الذين ظلموا أهل بيت محمد بأي منقلب ينقلبون والعاقبة للمتقين صلى الله عليه وسلم.
اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد.
Brothers and sisters, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. It's my pleasure to be with you and at your service inshallah for the next 10 nights. And hope that we can all benefit from each other and together try to become Al-Husayniyun and the Zainabiyyat. Inshallah, we'll begin this journey together with a loud salawat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad.
Before beginning, inshallah, I want to speak a bit about the concept of sacrifice. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks to us in the Quran in Surah As-Saffat from ayah 100 to ayah 107 and explains to us the concept of sacrifice through the story of Nabi Ibrahim alayhi salam. When Nabi Ibrahim has a conversation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he tells him, Ya Allah, habli min as-salihin. Ya Allah, I want someone from the good doers. I want a son from the good doers, a mu'min. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends him his son Ismail. After time, of course, a son and a father, they bond, being, of course, Nabi Ibrahim, Nabiullah, he's a prophet, so with his akhlaq, his son and himself, they've created a bond. They love each other and whatnot. After time, maybe, depending on the difference in hadith, around 15 to 25 years, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes and tells Nabi Ibrahim alayhi salam, Ya Ibrahim, I want what you asked for back. What do you mean when you ask for it? So for example, me telling you I want a car and you go and buy me a car, and then 5 years later you tell me, hey, I want my car back. What do you mean you want your car back? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked Allah, Ya Allah, habli min as-salihin, give me a son which is a mu'min. He gives him Nabi Ismail alayhi salam. After a couple of years he tells him, Ya Ibrahim, I want Ismail, I want you to sacrifice Ismail. And Nabi Ibrahim alayhi salam says, okay. He goes to Ismail and tells him, my son, I have seen a vision where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants me to sacrifice you. And Nabi Ismail tells him, and what's the problem? Inshallah, you do what you have to do and you will satajiduni inshaAllah min al-sabirin. You will see me from the patient ones inshaAllah. So they went to the mountain. And Nabi Ibrahim alayhi salam puts his son in front of him. Obviously, this is an extremely emotional moment for Nabi Ibrahim. And it's a very hard moment for Nabi Ibrahim. But look at the sacrifice and the acceptance that Nabi Ismail had. He didn't even question it. He said, yes, just do it. You have to do what you have to do, do it. So he puts him and he gets the knife and he's about to beat him. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends Jibreel and he tells him, wait, stop. So Nabi Ibrahim alayhi salam stops. Shufi, shulosa. It tells him, you have completed your task. You don't have to behead Nabi Ismail. But what I do is, I put a lamb in front of you, and you behead that lamb, you finished, you've done what you had to do. So, he finished, he left Ismail alayhi salam, and then he beheaded the lamb. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَفَدَيْنَاهُ بِذَبْحٍ عَظِيمٍ. And we have granted him, this is a great sacrifice. Meaning that this sacrifice, Ya Ibrahim, will never forget it for you. That's why you find till today, millions and millions of Muslims at the time of Hajj, they go, and part of this obligatory pilgrimage is to sacrifice a lamb. Many of us would be aware. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has kept his promise with Nabi Ibrahim alayhi salam. He said, we will not forget your sacrifice, and we'll leave it from now to Yawm al-Qiyamah, to the Day of Judgment. But then you look at Imam Hussain alayhi salam. Abu Abdullah, not only did he sacrifice his son, he sacrificed his brothers, his sister, for the daughter of Bani Hashim to go captive is a sacrifice. It's the biggest sacrifice. His daughters, his friends, his companions, he sacrificed them all.
to the extent where heads are stacked on top of each other, bodies are stacked on top of each other, arms are cut off. It's all a sacrifice. And then you have a woman like Sayyidina Zainab coming out and saying, Ma ra'aytu illa jameela. And then that's when you say, you find Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't forget this from Hussain alayhi salam. The same way He granted Ibrahim alayhi salam the great sacrifice and never let anyone forget it. From that day to the day of judgment, you find the beautiful youth like yourselves every year, from the day you could remember, in these 10 nights or 40 nights depending on the programs, you find that you don't forget Allah Abdullah Hussain alayhi salam. And every year, to commemorate the istishhad of Hussain alayhi salam, you come together and recite majalis together. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has fulfilled the promise from Hussain alayhi salam. Al-Husaynu ibrah wa abra. Not only is he a tea, yes, it's a cold, golden tea, you cry for it, but also it's a platform of knowledge you understand and you learn through the name of Imam Hussain alayhi salam. But the question is, why Hussain? That's the question. Someone might ask, why Muhammad Dhainii? Why wasn't it Imam Ali that rose? Why wasn't it Imam Hassan that rose? Why was it Imam Hussain? Common question. To understand this and to answer this question, you have to just go back a bit in time, rewind, into the times of ignorance, the age of ignorance, Iyam al-Jahiliya. To understand what were the Arabs at the time, you find that the Arabs were all ego-driven back in the days, before Islam, pre-Islam I'm talking. They were, in Arabic they call them min fa'alin, they're always on heat. And if they find a, like basically nowadays when you find like Justin Bieber does a hairstyle or David Beckham does a hairstyle, everyone does a hairstyle. Just everyone just goes with the groove, you know. Same thing. The Arabs are like that. When they see a strong leader, a big leader, they go with the groove and they follow this leader. It's not because they love this leader or they believe in this leader. And obviously, I'm talking about maybe 70 to 90%. I'm not talking about 100% of the Arabs, but 70 to 90% were this way. That's why when you find that when the Prophet ﷺ came and he tried to establish this Islamic government, at the start everyone was against him and he had to be exiled, he had to go to Medina, he had to go from Mecca to Medina. He goes to Medina, strengthens his army, comes back to Mecca and everyone's like, yes, yes, we want Islam. Not because they started thinking and believing, simply because Nabi Muhammad had a bigger number at the time. So that is a very big and strong aspect to remember. Then comes the time where the Prophet passes away. You find that the Arabs in one day begin to create their own, you know, their own government, where they want to choose their own Khalifa and whatnot. So they go and do so. They choose Abu Bakr as the first Khalifa. Some might ask, why didn't Imam Ali alayhi salam rise against Abu Bakr, knowing that he is the rightful Khalif and rightful Imam and whatnot? Imam Ali alayhi salam at the time sees that the infrastructure of Islam at the time was very weak. Hence, why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi, before he passes away, he tells him, Ya Ali, alayka bis-sabr, alayka bis-sabr, alayka bis-sabr. You need to be patient after me, you need to be patient, you need to be patient. He said it three times. You may ask why? Ya Ali, they're gonna come and they're gonna reject you. They're gonna make fun of you. They're gonna attack you. They're gonna attack your wife. They're gonna attack your house. They're gonna break your ribs. They're gonna kill your wife. But be patient. Because Islam is not strong enough for you to rise yet. Hence, also, why when one of the companions comes to Imam Ali alayhi salam, tells him, Ya Ali, why don't you rise and you're the right Khalifa and we want you and whatnot? He said, okay. 40 of you, I want 40 of you to come tomorrow morning and shave your heads bald. In the morning, shave your heads bald and come to a specific place. He wakes up the next morning, there's eight. Eight boys, eight men, eight companions, what are you going to call them? You look into what can. You want to rise up against the Khalifa, the Khalifa has 20, 30, 40,000 men. You want to rise up against the Khalifa, you can't even cut your hair bald. So Imam Ali alayhi salam was at a state where khalas, he has to sit, stand with the Khalif at the time. Imam Khomeini, Qudus Sirruhu Sharif, says that the first three Khulafa upheld the name of Islam. they publicly pray and read Quran and Hajj and Zakat and whatnot. This was all uphill. So the Imam alayhi salam would stand next to Abu Bakr at his time, Umar at his time, and Uthman at his time, and answer the questions of the Jews, answer the questions of the Christians. So, because obviously no one's going to be able and capable of answering the questions like Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam. After the third Khalifa's demise, obviously, he comes and before he passes away, the third Khalifa Uthman, he chooses Muawiyah, which is his cousin, Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan. He chooses him as the governor on Sham, Damascus. And he leaves him there. Being his cousin, Uthman wants to strengthen the Umayyad state, Bani Umayyah. So he said, alright, you know what, I'll choose Muawiyah, being he's the smartest one in Bani Umayyah at the moment, very intellectual, very, very switched on. I'll choose him and leave him there for now. Uthman passes away, then the Alam, the people come and say, we want Ali ibn Abi Talib as the Khalifa, so they choose Imam Ali alayhi salam. Imam alayhi salam starts to build and strengthen the Iman in these believers. He starts to build them, and then he realizes that Muawiyah is becoming shifty. He's ruining the name of Islam. He's ruining the Prophet, the Risala of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So what he does is, and he goes and he tells Muawiyah, Uthman put you in governorship of Sham, and now it's I'm Khalif now, I want you to get out. And Muawiyah says, no, make me. So Imam Ali alayhi salam says, okay. He gets them the army of the Muslims into Harb, the war of Safin, and he goes, and they almost win the war, until Amr ibn As comes and he says, he looks at Muawiyah and he says, Muawiyah, man, we're going to lose this war, what do we do? Muawiyah says, I don't know. Muhammad ibn As says, I have a good idea. He says, what's your idea? He says, we'll put the Quran on the speed. What do you mean, put the Quran on the speed? He says, put the Quran on the speed and watch, the Muslims won't do anything. So they put the Qur'ans on the spears, they put the spears on the ground, showing that if you want to attack us, attack us, but we're going to attack you with the spears in the Qur'an. So the Arabs come, the Muslims, they look at Ali ibn Abi Talib, Imam Ali is telling him attack, they're like, Ya Ali, how are we going to attack? They have the Qur'an on the spears, these are Muslims. He tells them, you're going against my word, I'm the Imam of your time, and you're going against my word, I'm telling you to attack. He said, but how can we attack? These are Muslims. So the Muslims spread, they spread into three different groups. One third say, yes, we'll attack. The other third say no, and the other third just, you know, whatever. So you find that even at the time, Imam Ali alayhi salam, this is 40 years after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa passes away, you find that the Muslims are still very wobbly. They're not strong on their feet. And one single command from the Imam, and they still can't. They can't handle it. So he goes, he leaves it, Imam alayhi salam passes away. Like, what happens then? You have Imam Hassan alayhi salam and Muawiyah. Imam Hassan alayhi salam also still doesn't have the number yet. Doesn't have the number. So he goes and Muawiyah comes up to him and he tells him, because Muawiyah knows that, Allah, you have Imam Hassan, I'm at a very, you know, risky. If Imam Hassan comes and gains companions and whatnot, it's going to be very risky. So I'm going to do a peace treaty with Imam Hassan alayhi salam. This is what Muawiyah is thinking in his head. He's very smart, very tactical. So he does a peace treaty. Obviously, Imam Hassan alayhi salam, which is our second Imam, he writes all the conditions. And one of the main conditions of this peace treaty, is that Imam Hussain alayhi salam, after Muawiyah's death, Imam Hussain takes Khalifa. He becomes a Khalifa, his rightful position. Obviously, with a lot of conditions. So he goes and he says, after Imam Hassan leaves, they've read this peace treaty and they've all accepted that Imam Hassan is going to be the next Khalifa. The hadith say that Muawiyah put this peace treaty under his foot and stepped on it, and he laughed at Imam Hassan. He said, you know, we tricked him. Then comes Imam Hussain alayhi salam. Imam Hassan alayhi salam at the time, like we said, he didn't have enough companions. Didn't have the number to rise. So Imam Hussain comes and obviously he can't rise against Muawiyah for a reason. Because that main condition to be played out, Muawiyah has to die. So if Imam Hussain alayhi salam rises against Muawiyah, everyone's going to be like, look, the son of Fatima, the son of Ali, went against the peace treaty. Whereas everyone knows that Muawiyah went against the peace treaty, but that's what they're going to say. So they'll blame Imam Hussain alayhi salam for the name of Islam, you know, getting ruled. So Imam Hussain alayhi salam comes and he says, okay, I'm going to stand down and wait for Muawiyah to pass away. So he waits, Muawiyah passes away. Who does Muawiyah put? Yazid. Imam Hussain alayhi salam looks, he says, nah, we can't have this. Muawiyah at the time was smart. To a certain extent, he used to pray in public. He used to read Quran in public. He used to actually show the people that he's Muslim. Whereas with Yazid, Sharib al-Khamr, he was known to be a drunkard. He was known to be qatil nafs al-muhtarama, to kill the innocent soul. He was known for that. He was known to play with monkeys. He was known for that. Around the Arabian culture, everyone knew what Yazid was. So for this man to take control of Islam and the Muslim Ummah, Imam Hussain alayhi salam said no. So Imam Hussain alayhi salam began to write letters to all around the Arabian world. A question someone might ask, oh, but why didn't Imam Hassan do that? Or why didn't Imam Hussain do that at the time of Muawiyah? Yes, at the time, no one knew what Muawiyah really was. Muawiyah, like we said, upheld Salah, upheld fasting, upheld the recitation of the Quran. Whereas when it came to Yazid, everyone knew what Yazid was. So when he sent these letters out, it was very easy for everyone to believe what Imam Hussain was saying. Very easy. So Imam Hussain has sent out thousands and thousands of letters, and he receives thousands and thousands of letters from Kufa, from Yemen, from everywhere around the Arabian world. And they all say, we are ready to fight with you, Abu Abdullah. So he's ready. He says, for me, to rise is much more important than to sit. Because the name and the message of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has not been upheld yet properly. Because of the historical events through the first three Khalifa and Muawiyah and Yazid. For me to rise, the only way I could rise is through bloodshed. That's the only way he could rise. So he goes to Muhammad ibn Khalafiyyah, which is brother. It's his brother from another mother, literally. And he tells him, brother, I'm gonna do 1, 2, 3. He says, Ya Hussein, my brother, why do you want to rise and get yourself killed? Allah jabrak, you know? You have four choices to choose between. He says, stay in Medina, and don't fight and don't do anything. Just, you know, chill, halas. Eventually, things will change. Or go to Mecca and try and enter the people there and try and fix, you know, connection between you and the people in Mecca and just let it flow as well. Or go to the Arabian tribes in the mountains that would love you to be there, you know. Or go to Yemen. You have a lot of Shia in Yemen. Why should you go and fight? Hussain looks at him and says, Ya Muhammad, all of these choices you've given me, which one raises the name of Islam? None. Yazid's going to be up there and he's going to be taking control of the Islamic world. What happens? The only way that we could keep the story of Rasulullah, the name of Rasulullah, up and intact is through my blood being shed. And not only through my blood being shed, but through my children coming with me, and through my sisters coming with me, and through my companions. So that's a question as well. Why did Imam Hussain alayhi salam take his sisters with you and all these women? Why did you take him with you, Abu Abdullah? He tells us, because if I were to go and fight by myself, people may think, he's left his family behind, you know, out of halrah, and whatnot. But when he takes his children and when he takes the women of Rasulullah, when he takes the daughters of Rasulullah with him, he's trying to send a message. The same way that Sayyidina Fatima alayhi salam chose to be buried in secret, so people could always ask that question, why is Fatima buried in secret? Why does no one know where Fatima alayhi salam is buried? That constant question that we always ask ourselves is the same question that is raised when, why did Imam Hussain alayhi salam take his woman with him? Because he wants to take wasil al-Rasul, he wants to let the whole world for centuries to come that this mission that I'm on isn't a personal mission. It's not for me. If it was a personal mission for myself, I wouldn't take my children, I wouldn't take my wife, I wouldn't take my daughters. I wouldn't take them. Heck, I wouldn't even take my son. Because I know I'm going to die. I know I'm going to be martyred. Why should I take him? So he says, no, no, no. It's not a personal problem. And through that, I'll show you. Who of us right now would purposely put our wives or our daughters or our sisters in danger? Purposely. In danger. Not in a situation of death and just danger. Just no. And if I told you, can you go have a car crash with your wife or with your sister or with your daughter? Like, no, why should I? Wrong way. Imam Hussain alayhi salam did that, but with all of the women of Rasulullah, all the daughters of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to send this message. Imam Hussain alayhi salam, before he chooses to rise and leave, he goes and begins to say goodbyes, his final goodbyes to his family. He begins with the Holy Prophet himself. He comes and tells him, Ya Rasulullah, look at what happened, what's happening to your ummah. And I'm taking it upon myself to come and rise against these tyrants. Ya Rasulullah, it's my time. And then he moves towards the grave, brothers and sisters, of which the position is still disclosed. Close your eyes and try and picture what would this lady be going through. Close your eyes. Tonight, on the first night of Muharram, a very special guest visits the grave of our beloved Fatima alayhi salam. A guest who is special to all of us. The guest we cry to meet. This guest is coming to send his condolences to his grandmother. إجا المهدي لقبر ما يعزيها بمصاب حسين يقلها كربلاء ما تصير يا يمه يقلها كربلاء ما تصير لولا كسرة الضلع يقللها يا يمه ثوب اللي فيه بعصرة صدرك تهشم يا يمه لا تنزعينا ولا تمسحين عنا الدم. He's telling his grandmother, صاحب الزمان is telling his grandmother, her mother, the clothes you were wearing when you were struck and hit by the door, the clothes you were wearing when they were all bloody from the wrecking of your ribs, keep them on, Ya Fatima, keep them on, and let's go. وتعالوا يا يما وتعالوا يا خلنا ندور من مأتمن إلى مأتم خلنا ويا الشيعة خلنا نروح ونهل دمعة العين. صاحب الزمان is telling his mother, يا فاطمة, keep your clothes on. I want you in a specific way. I want you to look like how you were on that night. on that day when the Mal'oon broke your rooms. I want to see you that way. And let's go meeting you from majlis to majlis and see how our Shia are sending their condolences to Abu Abdullah. It is narrated that Imam Hussain alayhi salam, at the age of 5 years old, goes to his mother Fatima alayhi salam, and he's crying, and he's telling her, "Mother, my grandfather broke my heart." She asks him, "How did your grandfather break your heart, Ya Hussain?" He replies, "I saw him kiss the mouth of my brother Hassan, and he kissed my neck, and that's why he broke my heart." So like a beautiful mother, she is, say the Zahra holds the hand of Imam Hussain alayhi salam, and she takes him. She takes him to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to ask him what he did, why he did what he did. So he tells her, "Your son Hassan, Ya Fatima, will be poisoned. And the poison will be so strong that he will spit his liver out. Whereas your son Hussain will be beheaded. He will be thirsty alone on the plains of Karbala." Fatima then screams out, "Ya walada wa Husayna wa Husayna." We will all be gone. Who is going to be around to mourn my son Hussain? He tells her, "Fatima, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make there be a Shia who will mourn your son Hussain from now till the day of judgment." So Fatima alayhi salam turns to her father and tells him, "Ya Aba, Ya Abata, O Father, and what will you do for this Shia?" This is you, brothers and sisters. He says, "Ya Fatima," the Prophet promises us, "Ya Fatima, I will not enter Jannah until they all enter with me, the ones who cry for Abu Abdullah." And then she turned to Ali alayhi salam and asked him what he will do for those who uphold the memory of Aba Abdullah. And Imam Ali alayhi salam says that he will quench their thirst with the water from the river of Kawthar. And you, O Hassan, she looks towards Imam Hassan alayhi salam and asks him. He says, "I will hold their hands on the Sirat and walk them into Jannah." You're getting the welcoming of Ahlul Kisa, brothers and sisters. And then she says, "Whereas for me, I will pick them like a bird picks its food." And then she looks at Aba Abdullah al-Hussain, a 5-year-old boy in the corner of the room, has his head between his legs, and he's crying, "Ya Hussain, and what will you do for those who cry for you, Ya Aba Abdullah?" Al-Mother, he replies, السلام عليك يا وارث نوح النبي الله، السلام عليك يا
خليل الله السلام عليك يا وارث موسى كريم السلام عليك يا وارث عيسى روح الله السلام عليك يا وارث محمد حبيب الله السلام عليك يا وارث أمير المؤمنين عليه السلام السلام عليك يا ابن محمد المصطفى السلام عليك يا ابن علي المرتضى السلام عليك يا ابن فاطمة الزهراء السلام عليك يا ابن خديجة الكبرى السلام عليك يا ثار الله وابن ثاره والوتر الموتور أشهد أنك قد أقمت الصلاة وآتيت الزكاة وأمرت بالمعروف ونهيت عن المنكر وأطعت الله ورسوله حتى أتاك اليقين فلعن الله أمة قتلتك ولعن الله أمة ظلمتك ولعن الله أمة سمعت بذلك فرضيت به يا مولاي يا أبا عبد يا مولاي يا أبا عبد الله أشهد أنك كنت نورا في الأصلاب الشامخة والأرحام المطهرة لم تنجسك الجاهلية بأنجاسها ولم تلبسك من مدلهمات ثيابها وأشهد أنك من دعائم الدين وأركان المؤمنين وأشهد أنك الإمام البر التقي الرضي الزكي الهادي المهدي وأشهد أن الأمة من ولدك كلمة التقوى وعلى بالهدى والعروة الوثقى والحجة على أهل الدنيا وأشهد الله وملائكته وأنبياءه ورسله أني بكم مؤمن وبإيامكم موقن بشرائع ديني وخواتيم عملي وقلبي لقلبكم سلم وأمري لأمركم متبع صلوات الله عليكم وعلى أرواحكم وعلى أجسادكم وعلى أجسامكم وعلى شاهدكم وعلى غائبكم وعلى ظاهركم وعلى باطنكم بأبي أنت وأمي يا ابن رسول الله بأبي أنت وأمي يا أبا عبد الله لقد عظمت الرزية وجلت المصيبة بك علينا وعلى جميع أهل السماوات والأرض فلعن الله أمة أسرجت وألجمت وتهيأت لقتالك يا مولاي يا أبا عبد الله قصدت حرمك وأتيت بقلبي إلى مشهدك أسأل الله أسأل الله بالشأن الذي لك عنده وبالمحل الذي لك لدي أن يصل على محمد وآل محمد وأن يجعلني معكم في الدنيا والآخرة آمين رب العالمين وصل اللهم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين